So, Farron, the obvious place to start this week is the horrible shooting on air, live shooting on a local news station where a reporter and a cameraman were killed in a shooting. A third person was also shot. She was the subject of an interview, and they were shot by a disgruntled worker, a former worker from that same TV station. In fact, a former reporter from that TV station who was clearly deranged, apparently had been pushed over the edge from what we know and from, I guess, a manifesto that he sent and was published, that he was pushed over the edge by the killing of eight people in a church down in Charleston. You know, at the end of the day, again, we just have another senseless shooting.
We have gone so far this year averaging one mass murder every single day of the year. I mean, that really tells you something about violence in America today. And when this shooter, the guy who killed this reporter and the cameraman and shot this other woman, when he says, like, I was incensed by this, you know, Charleston shooting, you know, violence isn't going to solve violence. If you go out there and start killing people as, I guess, revenge for other people being killed, you've solved nothing. You've created another problem. You've created more tragedy. You've destroyed the lives of these families forever. And so what could possibly possess somebody other than, you know, I believe his own selfish feelings towards these two individuals that he shot and killed. And so I don't necessarily believe his little claim that, you know, he was incensed by some of this other violence. I think we're dealing with a sick individual. And this was, again, a selfishly motivated, he wanted revenge for whatever reason. And you know, unfortunately, we'll never probably know what was fully going on in inside this guy's head when he decided to commit this atrocious act.
Well, that's right, because he ultimately pointed his gun on himself and took himself out. But really, at the end of the day, Farron, the issue is the ease in which people can get guns in this country. And here you have somebody and don't have the full sense of whether or not this guy was seeking treatment, or whether or not there was he had made any attempts to get help for what was obviously a psychological problem. And the reality is that you can't always get individuals to reach out for help so that they can be flagged as a potential problem. And even then, you wouldn't necessarily know. But what we could do in this country, if we were a sane and rational people, we would make it harder to get guns. Anybody who works in these fields with people who are ranging from those who deal with young people who have been sort of entered into a life of crime, as it were, and have find themselves caught up in the judicial system or the child services system, or with folks like this, understand that it is the ease in which people can get guns which allows them to carry out these type of massacres. Because the fact of the matter is, regardless of how upset this guy was, it's not that easy to get a gun. And unless you can get it from somebody who has easily gotten it by going to you know, some type of gun show loophole, or you can walk into your local Walmart and purchase a gun, these aren't criminal masterminds. These aren't people who are going to take a long-term project to secure a weapon. And in the event that they actually had to get involved in some type of, you know, black market or deal with more people to get a gun. It's just more opportunity for the authorities to find them and to be aware of them. And so it's the ease in which people get guns in these countries which bring this about. At the end of the day, that is the ultimate reality that, of course, is ignored by these gun fanatics.
You know, immediately after this happened, I saw a great article on Salon.com that just talked about the fact that, you know, now is the time to talk about gun control. We're going to, and we have been hearing already, the talking points, the NRA-sponsored talking points of now's not the time. Let's not politicize this. Let's not, you know, focus on, let's just focus on the fact that this was a tragedy, that people are suffering, and that's what we need to do. You know, we have to give them our thoughts and our prayers. Well, we have to do that, but we also have to open this dialogue about gun control in America. You know, if not now, when? Tomorrow, when the next mass shooting occurs, statistically? I mean, it's time to have this serious discussion. And we have to remember the fact. I mean, this is so important here. The NRA is one of the most politically unpowerful groups, lobbying groups, in the United States. 99.2% of the candidates and issues that they back, that they put money behind, fail. They have a lower success rate than almost any other group out there, and yet we're all terrified of them. Republicans especially, they're terrified to go against the NRA as if they have some sort of real power. The only thing the NRA is out there for is to sell guns, because the gun manufacturers are the ones who supply the group with money. They're the ones who provide that lobbying money. This is not about we're protecting your Second Amendment rights. That is absolutely just completely fabricated. They're out there to make money, and they make money when people die. That's just the sad reality of what the NRA really is. And I think that's where we start this discussion on gun control. Let's get the NRA out of the discussion, and let's get some serious, grown-up, responsible people in Washington to talk about the fact that something has to be done. We have to stop the constant violence in the United States.